Hello children, welcome to my channel Learn with Love. Today we are going to learn the prose The Refugees written by Pearl S. Buck. Look at this picture. This is Pearl Seidenstricker Buck. She was born on 26 June 1892 in the United States and her parents were missionaries. Missionaries were people who went from one place to another to teach other people about their religion. Pearl S. Buck's parents were Christian missionaries. They worked in China. They preached Christianity and tried to spread the religion in China. Even though our author was born in the United States, soon after her birth, her parents moved to China. And so our author spent most of her life before 1934 in China. She even has a Chinese name. It is Sai Zhenzhu. Her novel The Good Earth won the Pulitzer Prize in 1932. In 1938, she was awarded the Nobel Prize in Literature. It must be noted that she was the first American woman to win the Nobel Prize for Literature. Look at this world map. This is China. This is where our author Pearl S. Buck's parents moved to do their missionary work. But in 1931, something very bad happened here. The river Yangtze flooded. Now this is no ordinary river. It is the longest river in the continent of Asia. And it is the third longest river in the world. And this river flows in China. Look at this map of China. The river Yangtze is marked in a blue line. See how long it is? It runs across the country. Imagine how much damage it would have caused when it flooded. How many people would have died? And during this time, our author was in China. Remember I told you, Pearl S. Buck spent most of her life before 1934 in China. And this flood happened in 1931. Many people were swept away by the flooding of the Yangtze River. The crops in the villages were ruined. The people had lost everything in a day, their loved ones, belongings, and livelihood. And this story describes the plight or sad situation of the peasants, that means poor farmers, who were forced to leave their village due to floods and starvation. To starve means to suffer or even die due to lack of food. Their crops were ruined and their belongings were washed away, and hence the people were starving. They couldn't stay in their village anymore, for there was no food or job available there. The land has been flooded. What other work would these poor peasants, that means agricultural laborers, do? They were forced to leave their village in order to escape floods and starvation and move to the city as refugees in search of job and food. Children, people who are forced to leave their country to escape from something like a war or a natural disaster like tsunami or earthquake or floods are called refugees. The title of our lesson is The Refugees because it is the story of villagers who had been forced to leave their villages to escape from the floods. They escaped to a nearby city, and this story describes their misfortunes and untold miseries, that means sadness which is too much to be measured. The story describes the extreme physical and mental distress they had to suffer in the city. The writer's description of their hardship is deeply touching. That means it arouses our feelings of sympathy towards these refugees. The refugees walked through the city. They had come only from villages which are nearby, but they felt strange. They felt alien. They felt as though they had come to a faraway country. Even though their village was only nearby, to them it felt very far. Maybe because they had no idea when they would be returning to their homes or whether they will be returning at all. They were only accustomed or used to walking on rough country roads and fields, for they had never come to the city before. For the first time, their feet were treading upon concrete sidewalks. The word tread means a person's manner of walking or the sound made as they walk. Many of these refugees were coming to the city for the first time in their lives, and the streets were filled with so many sights and things they had never seen before. But they did not look at anything, but passed as if they were dreaming, with their eyes wide open. Are you wondering why they did not even take a look at anything? You see, these refugees had lost people in their families to the floods. They had no money and were probably starving for a long time. They were close to death, and nothing would seem interesting to a person who is close to death. Several hundreds of them were walking through the villages. They did not look at anyone. The people of the city also did not take a look at them. The arrival of refugees every day in hundreds had become a common everyday sight for the city dwellers, that means the city people. So even they did not look at these refugees with any interest. Since the people were coming from many villages to the city was full of refugees. They were fed after a fashion. After a fashion would be a new phrase for many of us. After a fashion means that something is done but not very well. If I say she was educated after a fashion, I mean that she was given an education but not a good one. Now do you understand the phrase after a fashion? These refugees were fed after a fashion. That means they somehow managed to eat but not well. Not even one good meal a day. They were clothed somehow. They didn't have much clothes with them. They had lost everything in the floods. And the government had constructed huge tents or camps outside the city for these refugees to stay, because there was not enough place for everyone to stay in the city. The refugees were wearing ragged clothes. Ragged means old and torn. It describes their miserable condition. These ragged men, women, and children could be seen at any time of the day, and they were all moving towards the camps. Notice the words few children. This probably means that many children had already died due to hunger and fatigue. The refugees had no sympathy from the city dwellers either. The people of the city wondered to themselves when these refugees would ever stop coming to the city. They felt that they would become poor and starve if they try and help these refugees a little, because there were so many refugees. The people of the city were bitter or angry with the refugees, not because they were unkind or cruel, it was because they were afraid. It was a bitterness or anger due to fear. So the shopkeepers bawled or shouted and yelled rudely to these refugees, who came every hour begging for some food or money. How would they earn anything if they helped out so many refugees? They were angry. The refugees tried to earn some money by pulling rickshaws. Look at this picture. This vehicle is called a rickshaw. Sometimes it's pulled by a horse, or it's pulled along attached to a bicycle, and sometimes it is pulled by people. The refugees were trying to earn some money by pulling rickshaws. But the men who traveled in these rickshaws were ruthless. They were merciless. They paid only 1/10 of the money to the refugees. That means if they had to pay 20 rupees, they paid only 2 rupees. But since these refugees were desperate for some money or food, they had to accept whatever was given to them. The refugees were trying to earn money somehow and they swarmed into unskilled jobs. That means many people started doing unskilled jobs. Unskilled jobs are those which do not need education or much training, like a garbage collector or a construction laborer, cleaner, etc. And these refugees started doing unskilled jobs for very low money. So even the city people were at the risk of losing their jobs to the refugees or being paid very little money. It made them more bitter towards the refugees. Every frozen dawn, dawn means early morning, every cold morning, many refugees were found dead on the street, for they were no more able to bear the hunger and cold. And one day, at the time of twilight, twilight is that time of the evening just before the sun sets and the world becomes completely dark. During that time of the evening, a fresh horde, that means a new and a large group of refugees, came to the city. But these people were not riffraff. Riffraff means people from a low social class. They didn't look like riffraff. They were not people who were poor or got easily starved during a flood. They looked like people of whom any country would be proud of because they were hard workers. But due to the flood, even these people had to leave their village. One look at them made it clear that they were all from the same region. That means from the same place, because they were all dressed alike. Their garments or clothes were woven or made of a dark blue cotton. The sleeves of their dress were long and their coats were full. The people wore smocked apron. Look at this picture. The lady is wearing a white apron in it. Apron is a piece of clothing which we wear above our dress so our dress wouldn't get dirty. And these refugees who had just come to the village were wearing smocked aprons. Do you see a design in the apron shown in the picture? That design is called smocking. Smocking is a decoration done on clothes by gathering the material into a tight pleated pattern. This design or smocking was done in curious or unusual and intricate design. Intricate means detailed. All the women wore blue colored bands on their head. Their way of dressing clearly indicated that they were all from the same village. They all dressed alike. The men and women looked very strong, but the women's feet were bound. The word bound is the past tense for bind. And to bind means to tie something up tightly. Why were the feet of the women tied tightly? You see, long, long ago, the Chinese believed that women should have tiny feet. They had the idea that only women with tiny feet were pretty. They felt that no man would marry a man with big feet. So to keep their feet from becoming bigger, the Chinese girls were forced to tie their feet very tightly to keep it from growing to its full size. They did it even though it was very painful to please the men. Thankfully, this practice does not exist anymore. It is banned now in China. But this is the reason why the women's feet were bound. Every man and lad carried a burden. Burden means heavy weight. They carried padded quilts, that means warm bed covering, which were stuffed with soft material to keep warm. They had some clothes. They also carried a huge cauldron with them. Cauldron is a huge metal pot with handles and a lid. Cauldrons are usually used for cooking outdoors. Look at this quilt. See how thick it is? That is because it is padded. That means it is stuffed with soft material. And the second picture is a picture of a cauldron. And these refugees carried quilts, clothes, mats, and cauldrons with them. When these people understood that they cannot survive in the village anymore, they had taken their cauldrons from the earthen ovens. You can see what an earthen oven is and how it looks from the picture below. They packed their belongings and with a heavy heart left their village. Even though they carried baskets and cauldrons, there was not even a vestige, that means a trace of food in them. It was evident that no food had been cooked in their cauldrons for a long, long time. This means that they didn't have any food or money left and they had been starving. They had been suffering without food for a long time. They were coming as a group at the time of twilight and in the lack of light. Or in the soft glowing light, these people looked well. But when looked at closely, one could understand that they had been suffering without food for a long time and had come to the city having no other option. They were too near death. They had been starving for a long time and they were too near death that they passed the city unseeing, silent and alien. Even though the city was full of new sights and things that they had never seen before, nothing moved their curiosity. That means nothing interested them. These people did not leave their village immediately after the floods. They had stayed by their land faithfully, but when they had eaten all the food they could save, and when they had no other option, they had decided to come to the city as refugees. The people were moving as in a procession. When a number of people or vehicles move together in an orderly fashion, it is said to be a procession. And at the end of this procession of men, women, and children was a little wizened old man. Wizened means wrinkled with age, like the sweet grandfather shown in this picture. There was a wizened old man walking slowly at the end of the group. Even this old man carried two baskets with him. He hung the baskets on a pole, that means a long slender piece of wood. Like everyone else, in one basket, he also carried a folded quilt and a cauldron. But in the other basket, he seemed to carry an extremely old, torn, but clean and neatly stitched and repaired quilt. Quilt means the warm bed covering. The load that the old man carried was very much lighter than what the others were carrying. But the old man struggled even to carry that light load. It was too much for the old man. It was clear that he must not have done any hard labor or any hard physical work in the recent past. He was beyond the age of work. He was too old to work, and he was unaccustomed or not used to doing such difficult works in the recent years. He struggled to breathe, walk, and even see. He staggered. Stagger means to walk unsteadily. He strained his eyes to see the people from his village who were walking in front of him. He was afraid that if he didn't walk fast enough, the others would leave him behind and walk away. But he was too old, weak, tired, hungry, and in pain that he could not walk anymore. He looked pitiful and he was in agony. Agony means extreme pain. This poor old man was in extreme pain. The old man could not walk anymore. Even though he was afraid of being left behind by others, he simply could not take another step. So he gently placed the burden he carried onto the road and sat down with his head between his knees. His cheeks were flushed from tiredness and he panted. He was out of breath. And as the old man sat there, a vendor who sells noodles set his stand near the old man and started selling noodles. It was night time by then and the light from the noodle stand fell on the old man's drooping or bending figure. Many people walked by the old man, but one man stopped when he saw the poor old man on the roadside. The old man reminded the passerby of his father who was no more. So he wanted to help the old man. But he himself was a poor daily wager. He muttered to himself that if he gave what little money he had to the old man, he wouldn't be able to feed anything but noodles to his own family. But he simply couldn't ignore this poor man. He thought to himself that if his own father had been alive, he surely would have given the little money that he had to his father. Thinking so, he decided to help the old man. He fumbled or he searched clumsily and took a silver coin from his ragged girdle. As we learnt already, ragged means old and torn, and girdle is a belt worn around the waist. His ragged girdle symbolizes how poor he himself is. He thought for a moment, added a copper coin to the silver coin, and gave it to the poor old man and told him to buy some noodles. But the old man did not immediately put out his hand for money. He was no beggar. He was a proud and hard-working man. So he said to the man, or he said to the passerby, "Sir, I did not beg of you." And saying so, he proceeded to talk about his difficulty. He said that the people of their village had good land, and people who had good land would never starve like this. But they had been reduced to this situation due to the floods. He added that their people were too hungry that they had eaten even the seeds they had kept aside for sowing the next year. Even though the old man refused to put out his hand and accept the money, the passerby gave the money to the old man anyway. He dropped the coins. He dropped a silver coin and a copper coin into the old man's apron and went his way. The vendor who had set his stand near the old man was watching all this and he asked the old man how many bowls of noodles he would like to buy. Only then the old man stirred. The word stir has two meanings. One is to mix something. And the next meaning is to move slightly. The old man moved slightly. He felt eagerly in his apron, and when he saw that there were two coins, he ordered only one small bowl of noodles. When the vendor heard this, he was astonished. He was greatly surprised. The old man looked so hungry, yet he orders only one small bowl of noodles. He asked the old man if it would be enough for him. But the old man strangely replied that the bowl of noodles that he ordered was not for himself. The vendor was astonished yet again. There was no one with the old man. He was alone, and yet he says that the bowl of noodles he is ordering is not for himself. But the vendor was a simple man, and he didn't want to ask too many questions. So he prepared the bowl of noodles, gave it to the old man. The vendor gave the bowl to the old man and was waiting eagerly to see who is going to eat it. Children, rise means to go from a lower position to higher position. And rose is the past tense form of rise. The old man rose, that means he got up with great difficulty. He took the bowl. His hands were shaking because he was so weak. He then went near the basket that he was carrying and gently pulled aside the quilt, that means bed covering, which was in it. Much to the vendor's surprise, a small boy was lying in it. A small boy was lying inside the basket which the old man was carrying so far. His eyes were fast closed, that means tightly closed. The boy's face was shrunken and he was so still that he appeared to be dead, but he wasn't. When the old man lifted the little one's head and put the bowl to his mouth, he started drinking the noodles feebly. Feebly means weakly. And the old man kept murmuring to him, "There, my heart, there, my child." The old man kept murmuring to the little boy comfortingly. The curious vendor asked the old man if the little boy was his grandson. The old man said that he was his son's only son. Both his son and his daughter-in-law, or his son's wife, had drowned in the floods. They were working on their land when the dikes broke and they couldn't escape. Dikes or walls built around huge water bodies to prevent flooding. But when the Yangtze River flooded, even the dikes broke. After the boy had drunk every last drop of the noodle, he covered the boy and then squatting on his haunches. Look at this picture. This man is squatting on his haunches. The old man too squatted on his haunches like this and started licking the bowl. After that, as if he had been fed, as if he had eaten, he handed the bowl back to the vendor. Children, like this grandfather, many of our parents and grandparents sacrifice their needs and hide their pains and try to create a safe and comfortable environment for us. They might not show it to us, but it is the dream of every parent that their child should lead a better life than them. They do not want their children to undergo the sufferings and difficulties that they had gone through in life. So we should never take their kindness for granted. It is our prime, first and foremost duty to treat our elders with utmost respect, love and care. For after all, we cannot be who we are without them. Also, you would not find anyone in this world who would give up everything else just for you. Coming back to the story. When the old man handed the bowl back to him, the ragged vendor, notice here, The adjective ragged describing the vendor helps us understand that the vendor was poor too. The vendor advised the old man to buy a bowl of noodles for himself with the other silver coin that he has. But the old man shook his head. He didn't want to do that. He had other plans for the silver coin. As soon as he saw the silver coin, he decided that he would buy seeds with it. He said that the young people of the village had eaten up all the seeds since they were too hungry and that they didn't have seeds to sow. Look at this picture. Seeds are being sown in this picture. To sow means to plant seeds by scattering it on earth. The vendor felt sad for the old man, but he himself was too poor to help him. So the vendor said to the old man that he might have given a bowl of noodles to the old man, but he didn't want to help someone who had a silver coin already with him. The vendor was puzzled. He was confused. He couldn't understand the decision taken by the old man. The old man replied that he did not ask for a free bowl. He also said that the vendor cannot understand his actions, as only a man who had land would know that if the land was not put to seed, there would be shortage of food and starvation the next year also. He planned to buy some seeds for, even if he dies of starvation, the others would plant it and hence there won't be starvation the next year. He thought that even though he would die, that was the best thing he could do for his grandson. Saying so, he took up his load again, his old legs trembling and straining his eyes down the long straight street, he staggered on. The old man's wisdom guided him to save the silver for future in hope that even though he dies, others would plant the seed. He was wise, selfless, and most importantly, amidst all that suffering, he had a hope for a better future. Children, we have come to the end of the class. Leave your doubts and suggestions in the comments section. I'll meet you in the next class. Until then, remember this. I love you all.